Hi, my name's Matt Widgery from mattwidgery.com. On today's episode, I wanted to share with you the picture that I made the other day, which was the flaming guitar picture. It's as you have, well, those of you that have been following the story through my Facebook page, and I've mentioned it on here a few times as well, it's a picture that I've been really looking forward to doing and have taken any opportunity to mention it just because I thought it's just something I really wanted to do. Basically, it was really cool. This is the guitar that we set fire to, and I'm actually really impressed by this. It's just a really cheap, it's a Cruiser by Grafter. Those of you that know guitars will know this is a pretty cheap one. It's not great in any way, but how good is that? I mean, it's actually been on fire. You can see on the back there more than you can see really on the front. This is what we did, was we took that back plate off and we'd like stuffed loads of paraffin rags into there, and then sort of set fire to those so that the flames were coming out, and then we were squirting lighter fluid, basically petrol all over it, and then Anna, the model, who you can see in the picture, it was kind of swinging around and smashing it into walls, and she's got these really amazing, beautiful dreadlocks as well, and they were swinging around, and we had to be really careful not to set fire to those as well, because they look really awesome. They would have looked cool on fire, but I don't think that she would have been so much a fan of that. As you can see from the picture, I'm really pleased with the way it turned out. I think it's captured exactly what I wanted. There were issues with it, which I only discovered when I got back to the computer and started to edit the image. In fact, the whole series of images that we took, we did that one and one or two others, that I wanted to share with you, because it was something that I learned a very strong lesson from, and I hope that by imparting the mistake that I made with this shoot, that maybe you guys can also learn from it as well. What we've got, as you can see in the picture, is a very high dynamic range between the bright spots of the fire and the dark spots of the shadows. Now, I don't know if it's going to come out too clearly on YouTube, but in the shadows there is a fair bit of noise and artifact that's coming through, where I've tried to pull back some of those shadows. And I was pulling these sliders, because normally, with RAW files, and I always shoot RAW, or I say always, this is where we're coming onto this in a minute, but mostly I shoot in RAW. I wanted to shoot this in RAW because I knew that from the where the flash was coming in and where the fire was coming in and then where the shadows were going to be, there was a huge dynamic range in the picture between the very brightest parts and the very darkest parts, and I knew that I wanted that latitude that the RAW file gives you in order to be able to, bring out some of the detail in the shadows if I wanted, or to maybe sort of shut down some of the highlights if they looked like they were getting too bright. However, and this is where I made my mistake, the other day I was out shooting a guy who was a BMX freestyler. And this is one of the images up on screen now. And he was spinning around and doing these incredible tricks on his bike. And I shoot, as again, those of you that follow this channel will know, a slightly older camera. It's a D300, Nikon D300. And it's brilliant. It's got an 8 frame per second burst, which allows me to, capture, I can basically fire off, if I'm doing one of these kind of spins that he was doing, I can actually capture it select the bit from that image the image out of that sequence that I think is the best. So I normally fire off in like 3 or 4 second bursts, just to be able to capture, maybe something with where he's looking at the camera, or he's not got his back to us or whatever. But the Nikon D300 won't shoot at 8 frames per second in RAW. It'll only do it in JPEG. So I set it onto the finest JPEG setting that it's got and fired that. And I'd forgotten that I'd done that when I came to shooting with Anna, which was in an abandoned pub in the middle of the night. It was dark, and in fact, when the flash wasn't going off and before the guitar was lit, there was literally no light in there at all. Much in the same way that we did with the Jake Martin shot. Do you remember we were talking about how we used a mobile phone to focus on his face? So the light from the screen was actually what the autofocus picked up on, and then he slung the phone up onto the bank so it wouldn't get wet. If you want to have a look at that tutorial, there's a link to it up on the screen now. But we would have to do a similar thing with Anna, because before the flash went off, which is what's lighting up her face and the wall, she was in complete blackness, obviously, and the guitar's lower down. So I had it set on JPEG, and so I didn't have the dynamic range that I thought I was going to have. So I knew I was making an image that had these very bright parts and very dark parts, and so that was, it caused me some problems in post getting that information back, and I didn't manage to pull out as much detail in the shadow that I'd want, and I didn't manage to control the highlights exactly how I'd want, simply because the JPEG compresses the information that you get out of your picture, and it gives you a lot less information to work with, and therefore it's much harder to to do editing. Whether it's color, whether it's contrast, all those things really, really, really suffer with a JPEG file. Unless you're planning to deliver the product straight out of camera and not really do much in terms of post-production, I would always, always, always recommend that you shoot in RAW as opposed to JPEG. So unless you're using a camera where, you know, for whatever reason, like the D300, and you need that fast frame rate or whatever it is, you know, and you need to be able to put it onto JPEG. So what did I learn from this? Because, this is all very well and good, but there has to be a lesson out of it somewhere. And I wanted to try and take something positive from this. The image, as it turns out, I like the image. I'm happy with the image. Okay, you know, maybe it's not perfect in the shadow areas, but I think that that's not really the most important thing to me about this image. And it's a punky, grungy image. Everything's gritty anyway. I don't think it's too much of a problem with this image. However, it was a mistake and I don't want to do it again. So what have I learned? Well, I have now started to reset my cameras, all of my cameras, to exactly the same settings after every use. Before I put them back in the camera bag, I reset everything on them. So I set it to, in terms of the exposure triangle, because I use Nikons, and some of the Nikons, like the D300, for example, ISO 200 is like the lowest ordinary ISO setting. I set it to that. The Nikon D5100 that I'm filming this one will actually set as its lowest normal setting, ISO 100, but I want everything the same. So I have that, I have the Ricoh GR, and I have the D300 all set at ISO 200 is the default position. I have it set at f8. I have it set at 200th of a second. I have it set up in full manual mode, and I have it set on single burst mode, so I'm not on multi-frame. I have it on single autofocus. I don't have it on continuous autofocus or on manual focus if I've slid those things around. And all of this, I have it on auto white balance because I shoot in RAW, so auto white balance doesn't actually make a difference to me. And I have it set back to RAW. So whatever I've been shooting, you know, if I've been going out and doing night photography and I've had it on some 30-second exposure, if I've been doing high-speed photography with the burst rate and I've had it on JPEG, whatever it happens to be, when I put those cameras back in the bag, I now always reset them to those settings. And it doesn't really matter what the settings are, to be honest. They're kind of, I guess, somewhere midpoint settings that are all right for, you know, other average shooting situation. But the point is that I know, because they're always set on that now, that when I get them out of the bag, I already know where I need to move the dial, if it's going to be up or down. And so it's much, much faster. And I also always know that things like RAW is always going to be taken care of, and I'm not going to have a problem with that. I know what autofocus mode I'm going to be in. I mean, just all this stuff I know because it's in my camera bag every time. So that's it. I've learned my lesson, hopefully. Never say never. Probably find I've done it again in the future, but I hope not. But I hope that even if I do make the mistake, that maybe it might sort of, just help one of, even if it's one other person out there from making the same mistake that I did on this shoot. Because, you know, it's just one of those situations where, you know, there's a lot to think about when you're on a shoot. Those of you that have, you know, sort of been out on these type of things know, and you've got sort of makeup artists and models and lights, and you know, you've got all these things in your head, and beyond all that, you're trying to get your creative vision to work. You're trying to, you know, pick exactly the right angle. You're trying to find, you know, exactly, you're trying to communicate with the model and the other people that are on set, and there's a lot that goes on in your head, and it's really, really easy to forget things, especially if you're a person like me who's, you know, I mean, I'm not the most organized person in the world, I'll be the first to admit it. I do forget things unless I've got everything written down, but you know, there's certainly occasions like that where it's just not so practical to have a checklist of things, besides which it was completely dark out there, so I wouldn't have been able to read it anyway. This is now my kind of safety net, that I will reset my cameras to every setting. But other than that, I've really just had a great fun time. Alicia, the makeup artist, was absolutely brilliant. It's the first time I've worked with her. Anna, the model, was great. I have worked with her in the past, so I knew she was going to be fantastic, especially for this shoot. I think, you know, just her look for this is absolutely amazing. And I hope you guys like the picture. If you like the video, please subscribe below or above. We'll have a button up on screen that you can actually click on. Otherwise, if you're watching it straight on YouTube, you can subscribe underneath there and check out some of the other videos on the channel. Many thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you again soon. Cheers.